What is up, Panther fans? The C3 podcast is back in action. It's your homeboy, the professor, a.k.a. Tony Dunn, here with my crew. It's Tuesday night. It's 10 p.m. and we're talking about the Carolina Panthers from the fan perspective. I'm here with my brother from another mother, that freaking Puerto Rican. He's back from the dead, literally. Back from the dead, Joe Riolano. We are glad you are here. We're glad you're back on the podcast, but we're glad that you're walking around, brother.
Yeah, well, you know, my wife, I'd like to think, would say the same thing, at least most of the time. Anyway, yeah, it's great to be back, man. You know, I've had a rough go over here the past couple of weeks, but I've got a lot to be thankful for. I've got a lot of people that care for me in my life. You two guys have been a tremendous help. I know you said a lot of prayers for me. But yes, I am glad to be back, and I am ready to get this show started.
We also got our brother from the West Coast mother, Del Mayock. Got the coolest jersey on the planet. Can you guys see this? First of all, if you're listening to the podcast later, you can't see it, but Mel Mayock is wearing a customized away. What is it? The special jersey? What do they call that?
Alternate.
The alternate.
Yeah. And
it's C3. His number is C3, and his name is Mel Mayock.
Yes, sir.
Been hanging around the West Coast, Washington. How's the grunge rock scene in Washington State? <you know?
laughs> Well, actually, last week, Professor, I was in Denver. So
it's kind of grunge.
I know it's tough to keep up, man. I'm all over the place. It's been a wild ride, but hey, you know, it seems like it's been an entire off season since we've done this show, and it's only been we took 1 week off for the first time in a year. But man, I missed it. It's amazing how much I missed it. Just not having it, I couldn't even watch it during the week. So it's good to be back, and it's always better when the freaking Puerto Rican's on the air. So glad to have you back, Joe.
We missed our first week in over a year last year. Last week, first in over a year. Pretty proud of that, to be honest.
Yeah.
I didn't know that we had been so consistent until we actually didn't have a show. Yep. We took a little vacation. Joe took his in the hospital. Joe's was the most expensive out of everybody's. But, you know, we needed it. And really, it's been the quiet time. But it was nice that we had people tweeting us saying, where's the show at? In a nice way. Like, is there going to be, no podcast this week?
So I don't know. Nice. I don't know about nice, man. I think Susan was pretty upset.
She was sad.
She was sad.
Susan's been bucking up on Twitter today about she's been
fantasy football.
Her C3 belt. around. All right, look, guys. We there's not a ton going on in the football world, but we got some things that we'd like to talk about. Tonight's episode. 15.21. If you guys don't know, somebody asked me, what the hell's up with your numbering system? It's the season 15, and this is the 21st episode of this year for us. So I started it after the Super Bowl. I can't believe that can be the case. Or maybe I started the numbering after our season ended. It's crazy. We've had 21 episodes in this year already.
Mm-hmm.
Benjamin and the Late Night Funchess is what we're talking about tonight. And we're going to be talking about a lot about Kelvin Benjamin, and I mean literally a lot. He's had the munchies causing him to pull a hammy. He came in a little overweight to the off-season workouts and the training camp or whatever, OTAs. So we're going to see if these munchies, if he's eating himself out of a job. And we don't got to worry about that. But, hey, I always have the munchies. And I might not get hamstring injuries, but I'm always eating a ham sandwich at some point throughout the week. We also got, guys, NFL.com, Matt Harmon, who's going to be a fantasy football writer, who is a Panther fan, also been with thefootballguys.com for a while now. He is the creator of Reception Perception. He's been feasting as of late, speaking of the munchies. he just landed a job with NFL.com as a fantasy football writer. So, you know, I can't wait to ask him, because I know there's a lot of people that write for us that have mentioned that they would like to do this full time, or that, you know, I think there's always that kind of dream of maybe this actually is more than a hobby. I mean, he's obviously done it more seriously than probably most of us have done. Mm-hmm. In fact, I try not to be serious at all, so... I'm gonna have the Onion might give me a job, but we'll ask him. He's done some great work with this reception perception. He breaks down the film and the tape about how what type of routes guys, and he did a couple of graphs on Kelvin Benjamin over an 8-game stretch, and we're gonna ask him about that and what type of receiver he can be for us. But before we jump into the show, guys, if you want to tweet the show, you can hit us up with the hashtag C3. You can hit me up on Twitter at @cat_chronicles. Mel, tell them how you get down on Twitter.
You could catch up with me anytime on Twitter at @PanthersDrafter. Had a big conversation today. Had a story that I put out this morning about fantasy football. Had a very big conversation going on about it. Check that story out at catchronicles.com. And hit me up on Twitter anytime. Love to talk football or anything else.
You can find Joe at Joe Riolano. I had to have Mel say his own his own Twitter name, because I always go, is it Panther Drafter or Panthers Drafter? Is
it Panther Drafter? Yeah, it's kind of confusing. Twitter is with an S, email's without it.
Okay. Now I'm all totally. Guys, I know everybody can't watch my beautiful face on YouTube, or you can only watch it for so long, should I say, but if you need to take Carolina Cat Chronicles, the C3 podcast, on the road with you. You can take it in your car, you can take us to the gym, you can take us to your mama's house, and you can do that by downloading us and streaming it through iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, or you can just go to our website and hit podcast and grab the RSS feed.
Hey, Professor, real quick, man, it's the 4th of July week. I want to give a quick shout-out to all the men and women overseas, the guys fighting on the front lines, making this a free country. Thanks a lot, guys. I mean, we couldn't sit here and do it without you.
That's for sure.
Joey, are you going to sing happy birthday to the United States before we leave?
No, but I might sing God Bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her with the light through the night with the light from above.
Nice.
I was going to sing happy birthday and then my son always goes, cha-cha-cha.
That's my son.
Cha-cha-cha. I don't know where it comes from, but I like it. Now
I think it's a school thing.
Cha-cha-cha. All right, well, let's cha-cha-cha into what's hot on C3.
Let's do it.
Good day, mate. Let's put another shrimp on the barbie.
Now, I'm just getting warmed up. Here's Charlie facing the fire, and there's George hiding in Big Daddy's pocket.
Dylan and Dylan, because I spit hot fire.
Like a flamethrower to this place.
What's hot on C3?
It's the quiet time of football season. You know, we are all dying for some football news. I watched a whole damn video, and it wasn't long. It was like 3.5 minutes of Luke Kuechly doing tennis ball drills, which were nothing at all. We are starving. So what do? When we starve, we talk about how we're going to three-peat. Wouldn't it be sweet to three-peat? Newest contributor on C3, Joe, I think you've already nicknamed him.
I have. I really like what he's put up so far. His name is Mike Pasta Wirecutters Hernandez.
And
he's got some serious potential, I think. We're more than happy to have him as a new contributor to the site.
Nicknames are not expressly the opinion of catchronicles.com. We take an asterisk to that nickname.
That's right.
I don't. I say he's busting onto the scene, passing the wire cutters.
That's right.
He's breaking out. He's breaking out. All right, so he put up a post this week that said three reasons the Panthers are going to three-peat. And I got to say, it would be sweet, wouldn't it?
That would be awesome.
Number one, Cam Newton era, the Panthers are 14-10 versus the NFC South. That's nice to hear, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. It really is. It really is.
I wonder if our friend Scott Karasik knows that.
Well, it certainly wasn't like that before Cam Newton. I can tell you that.
Certainly wasn't. That just goes to show how good Cam Newton really is, how much of a better team we are with him.
I saw, I put on, somebody was talking about what team do you hate the most? You know, just the typical, another offseason thing. This was on Reddit. And I said the Falcons. And it goes back to Mike Vick tearing up my college team, and then he goes and tears up my pro team later on. And I felt like the first five or six football games I went to were all losses to the Falcons. And the guy, a guy, some jackass, of course, is like, man, either you don't know how to count or you have the worst possible luck statistically because we're 16-24 against, so we have a losing record against them. So I just happened to go to, I guess, one, we lose every, what, two out of three games?
Right.
16-24, something like that. I don't know. I don't even know what the odds are on that. But I was just like, well, you know, it did suck while I was there. But Cam Newton, only one of those losses has been with Cam Newton at the helm. But I'm not very good to go with to Carolina football games, dude. I see us get blown out a lot. So yeah. It was nice when we went to Tampa Bay and Detroit the last
wait,
two.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. I'm spending good money to fly across the country and go watch the opening week game, and you're telling me I'm going with you, and you're telling me that you're bad luck?
Oh. I don't know, man.
Last two games we've been to, they've won.
Yeah, it might even be three because I think I've been to the last year we went to the Lions. I also went to the Jets and Tampa Bay the year before that.
Mm-hmm.
And all wins, so we're 3-0 in my last stretch.
All right.
But,
all right. Cool, I'll still go.
We're trending
up. I was also at the Giants game opening, maybe home opener. Two or three, where the one where we sacked Eli like seven times in the first quarter.
Oh, nice.
Right.
It was 34-3. That was in 2013. That was when Ted Ginn had his one deep pass of the season that everybody's like, oh, he's a deep threat. Oh, he sucks. All right. So Cam Newton. And Cam Newton's healthy, by the way. So that's good news. Number two, improved secondary, fellas, with the help of our front seven, can get after a quarterback, he says, and force bad throws or sack. Strip sacks, that's what I'm adding because I've been watching Thomas Davis on Family Feud. But what do you guys think about this? Is the secondary improved, Mel?
Oh, I think there's no question. I mean, last year we got a lot better when Sticky Wicky actually got healthy and Trey Boston got healthy. Both of them guys were dealing with nagging injuries at the beginning of the year. Just those two alone, having a good, healthy offseason coming into the year, starting out as starters this year instead of rookies trying to work their way in injured, that's going to be a big deal. And then you sprinkle in Peanut Tillman. Hey, if he's healthy, there's going to be nothing but better there.
And let me jump in here and say, according to the article actually that Mike wrote, in the article he was mentioning how we depended so heavily on our front seven before. Well, this year the difference is going to be our secondary will be able to contribute. And it's because of the stepping up, if you will, of Josh Norman, who he calls Lake Norman. I think that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
Benny Bidwithery, Trey Boston, and then you add in the seasoning of Peanut Tillman and what's his name? Grandma Harper. Yeah, those guys.
And then you got the Houston guy.
Right, and Houston, yeah. So you add those guys in, and the secondary is improved. But then I went on sort of a – I took that and went to the next logical step was, hey, now the quarterbacks are going to have to really be respectful of our secondary, so that will give our front seven a little more time to get to the mm-hmm. quarterback and sack him, sack fumble, or even make him throw bad throws that lead to turnovers. And we all know in the NFL, you get turnovers, you're going to get wins.
I'm still not sold on Trey Boston. We got to see. I want to see more than six games out of him playing well. There's question marks at safety all across the board, I think. I think Josh Norman is a tremendous asset. If we can just get if Peanut Tillman and the Houston guy can kind of cycle as a number two.
Hey, would you sign Josh Norman right now, or would you let him play out the year?
You know,
deep thoughts with the professor.
I would sign him. I mean, why not? I mean, before he gets, what if he if he has a great season this year? We're not going to be able to. I mean, we could afford him technically. We got the money, but he's going to command some big money if he goes.
I'd sign him now, man.
You know, but yeah, I mean, why not? Why not? I think you go ahead and lock him up and K1 short early and just get him off the board. Luke Kuechly, just go ahead and pay all those dudes. Third reason, though, what was the third reason, Joe?
Third reason
added weapons on offense. Yeah. That's
right.
What it was.
Right.
Is our offense better, though? Is it? It can't be any worse than it was last year.
No, I think that you're just looking at it on paper and you're like, wow, these guys are improved. We know what Kelvin Benjamin brings because we've seen him play for a year. We have an idea of what Funchess is going to bring because he's right along the same physique as Benjamin, a little more athletic than Benjamin. And then, of course, we've got old reliable Greg Olsen. And a healthy Jonathan Stewart is a big factor. If he can stay healthy this whole entire season and we just get marginally improved line play, I don't think this NFC South is going to be much of a competition.
Hey, somewhere out there, Philly Brown is raising his hand saying, don't forget about me, man.
Right. Absolutely.
A lot of reports. He's looking a lot better this year, too.
He was a nice surprise last year. I thought he was a lot better than any other guy that we had on the field other than, I mean, minus Kelvin Benjamin.
Right.
And Greg Olsen. Everybody's like, oh, don't forget Greg Olsen. But without him, we don't really have, we don't have anybody.
Mm-hmm.
So he's a given, folks. Just get over it. He's a given. I thought Philly or Corey Brown, I saw that the new football cards from Score, they listed him as Philly Brown.
Still.
Yeah. I mean, that's his name on
the
card.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. That's kind of crazy when your card is your nickname. What if, like, the Greg Hardy card was just the Kraken? Like, it didn't have his name.
Could you imagine the Anthony Dunn card just saying the professor?
I know. Duh, professor.
Duh, professor.
We got Matt Harmon coming on in just a minute, folks. Joe, tell them how, before he comes on, if they want to do any shopping for him or his friends or me and my friends or maybe even your own family, where would you go do it at?
I would go to Panther Fan. I would go to Amazon, but I would only go to Amazon through CarolinaCatChronicles.com. Why get off the couch? You're on your couch, you're on your computer, you're checking out all the hot takes on the C3 website, and maybe even watching some old past episodes of the C3 podcast. You just remember, oh, I got to get a birthday present for my great uncle Larry. And you decide, I'll check out what's on Amazon. Go to the Amazon link. I think it's under Shop Here or something like that.
Yeah,
it's
under the shop tab.
Under the shop tab. Click on Amazon, look at what you think your great uncle Larry is interested in, and hook it up. What's that?
We were just saying that if you wanted to buy our guest, Matt Harmon, a moving present because he is moving to LA. Matt Harmon, NFL.com writer now. How exciting is this? We're glad to have you on the C3 podcast. If they want to buy you a moving in present, they can go to Carolina Cat Chronicles and do it through our Amazon affiliate link.
That's
gorgeous. Maybe you'll get something in the mail. Matt Harmon, welcome to the C3 podcast.
Hey guys, thanks for having me. And I would—I actually don't want any more stuff. I've actually been packing all day, and I just continue to realize, wow, I really have too many things already that I need to get rid of. So I don't know if I don't know if any moving gifts. I don't know. Maybe more boxes. More boxes would be the correct gift.
At work, my office mate, and this is my favorite thing, is when people clean out their houses and then like give you gifts because they don't want the crap anymore. My mother does this all the time. She'll give my kids stuff like this, and they'll be like, "Take this home," and we're like, "No, we don't want this." My office mate at work gave me a sweatshirt, a Carolina Panthers sweatshirt, and it says NFC West on it.
Oh,
which is, it's old. I mean, this hug is like authentic. It's a relic. But all right, Matt Harmon, congratulations, Matt. You are now with NFL.com. Is that right?
Thank you. Yes. Yep. That's correct. I'll be starting July 13th. So between then and now, I'll be driving from. I'm actually going to be down in Carolina the next couple of days to celebrate the 4th, and then after that, I hit the road to go to California. So is it
cross-country trip? How long do you expect it to take, and are you taking your time, or are you plowing through?
Oh, I'm plowing through. I'll have all my stuff, my dad, and my dog. So we're just going to be hustling through this time around. So I think it'll take us about 4 days. Hopefully we can get it through. Get it all out of the way. At some point, I do want to take the whole long road trip, stop and take my time, because I do love sightseeing and traveling, so hopefully sometime after I can come back to the East Coast and visit and they do a little bit of sightseeing.
Well, hey Matt, this is Aaron, a.k.a. Mel Mayock. I live out in Las Vegas, man. Big fan of what you do. I like your writing. I like everything that you do, man. If you're ever out in Vegas, look me up.
Oh, yeah. Well, one of the good parts about working for NFL is I'll still be able to work with football guys, and we actually take a retreat out to Vegas every year in January. So
Yeah, look me up then. Cool.
How long has the football guys been around? Because I feel like I listen to their podcast every week or every 2 days, I feel like.
They're cranking out shows.
But they say things like, "We've been at this for 10 years," and I'm like, holy cow. I mean, I've been playing fantasy football since like 1999, but geez. Podcasting and fantasy football site, that's some legit street cred right there.
Oh, yeah. I know that Joe and David, the two creators, got together at some point, I think, in the 90s or the 2000s, long before I was at this. And I think Cecil and Sigmund came together probably, about 10 years ago. So it's they've been around for a while. It's a really great site.
They are rocking and rolling, guys. You can check out footballguys.com, the Audible podcast on the couch with Sigmund Bloom, even though I just call him Sigmund Freud all the time. Matt, we brought you on because you've done some great work with reception perception, creation. This is your baby,
mm-hmm.
The reception perception. Can you tell us about this project, how you got into it, and before we jump into Kelvin Benjamin?
Sure. So reception perception is my baby. It's a methodology that I've created to evaluate wide receiver play. I guess it all kind of started kind of for a twofold reason. One being that, I realized a year and a half ago when I set out to start writing about football, I was like, well, I'm a nobody. Nobody knows who I am. I'm going to need something to stand out. So that's why I wanted to kind of create something unique like this in order to get my name out there to the public. And I guess that ended up kind of working out. So that was kind of the motivation for that. And I guess I always wanted to be able to quantify things with wide receivers because it's such a dependent position, based on quarterback and offense. I wanted to create something to just strictly look at the receiver and how they were performing. And I felt like there was a little bit of a gap in the market for that. So that's kind of the aim behind reception perception, is to strip away everything else and just focus on the wide receiver and what they're doing compared to their peers around the league.
Does it feel good when somebody copies you? And I saw the same exact work for defensive backs by somebody.
Really?
But it was the same concept. Let's take 8 games or a sample group.
Mm-hmm.
Let's break down each play, see how they do in man, see how they do in zone, how they do against this route, how they do against that route. I cannot remember who I saw it with, but that's got to be one of the greatest compliments right there, is having somebody take a page from your work.
Right. Well, and that's something that I've always, you know, I get a lot of questions on is how do you account for the cornerback play? And I can't really because I'm only one man and, you know, I have a life that I'd like to live, so I can't chart it all by myself. So it's kind of, it's good for me to know that there are other guys doing similar work with other positions. I think it's, like I said, it was something that I thought across all positions needed to be done, and I just picked wide receiver because it's a fun, you know, I grew up watching Steve Smith play, and I loved watching receivers, so it just was a natural thing for me to choose. But it's
cooler cool than left guys, guard.
Yeah, right.
Way cooler than left guard.
No kidding.
Let's talk about this. You got three graphs that you put up about, or three charts, should I say, for Kelvin Benjamin, and this is your process. Do we start with this one right here, which is the type of coverage and his success against these coverages?
Yeah, and actually,
tell us about this.
I feel bad because the one I sent, this one we're looking at right now, is a little bit outdated. The one, because my averages, but when I calculated that one, have changed a little bit. So actually, just pretend that that man coverage rate is also in yellow, which would mean that it's right around the average for NFL receivers as in terms of success rate. So my bad on that one. I realized it about a couple hours after, or like right now I'm looking at it, I realized that. So
Okay. So the way this works, and for people that are going to be listening later, is that tell us, explain this graph and how it works to the listeners.
So what that graph is it's called the success rate versus coverage, or SRVC for short, and it's basically just about what it sounds, you know, how often they're getting open against each attempt of that particular brand of coverage. So for Benjamin, you see that I charted him over an 8-game sample, which is what I use for reception perception. I charted him going against man coverage 146 times, and he was successful on 63.7% of those, which is right in line with the NFL average that I have. And I've sampled about, I think, anywhere between 50 to 60 guys. So, again, and then same thing, there's a zone coverage one and one against double coverage and press coverage. And it's what's funny about Benjamin is that he was within one percentage point of the average for man, zone, and double coverage, but was well above average against press coverage. So I think it's just, you know, I won't get into takeaways, but that's kind of the explanation of what that chart is and what it means.
I wanted to ask you a question. This is Joe Ruano, a.k.a. the freaking Puerto Rican.
How's it going, Joe?
I was looking at that, and I think it's brilliant work that you're doing there. I really do believe that. I played a receiver in high school and college, so I really do have a deep appreciation for what you're doing there. But you said they were successful. You know, you see the success rates over there all the way to the right. That doesn't necessarily mean that the ball was delivered to them. You're just saying at some point in that route they were open.
Correct, yeah. And that's something that I've always wanted to see a quantifiable percentage to, because you just kind of hear that term thrown around a lot, like, oh, well, this guy's always open, but the quarterback's not getting him the ball, or, oh, this guy is always covered, and that's why he can't get open. So I wanted to kind of look at every route that they run and really quantify that again, and just be able to have one number that really is a hard representation of how often they're getting open. So yeah, it's not based on it's not based on whether they caught the pass, whether they were even targeted, but just how much they're running the route.
So after you do that, or in the process, what you do is you chart each type of route they run,
yes.
Whether it be a dig route, a corner route, the nines, and you do this, and some of these, you know, these guys are running all different types of routes. You do the same pattern of routes for each receiver. And this one, when you tweeted it out, and this was probably Ben, I saw you put this out maybe like 2 months ago, I feel like, and you said something to the effect of, well, this is not the most diverse chart or that I've made through this. Tell us about the routes that Kelvin Benjamin runs that you've discovered.
So just looking on his route tree, and it's on the screen there that you're showing, it's over 60% of his routes are slants, posts, and nine routes, which is really unbalanced sometimes. So those are the only ones that he's running above the NFL average for those routes, and it's well above the average. So and while some people want, I think this is an interesting, you know, kind of just like reality about receiver play, is that there are so many different ways to play the position. And just because a player is limited in what he can do or what he's being asked to do doesn't necessarily mean that he's a poor player or a bad player. Because you can have what I like to call trump cards. Like, I mean, we all watch a lot of Kelvin Benjamin, and we see some of the things that he can do on, you know, short patterns as far as boxing guys out and making plays in coverage, that it doesn't necessarily, just because he's not this well-rounded, technically sound route runner, doesn't mean that he's a bad player. If he's just succeeding in these really small factions of the game, that's not, again, I don't necessarily see that as a negative, but it just, what reception perception's goal is with the route percentage chart is just to kind of show what they do on a regular basis, you know, not necessarily, you know, if that's a bad, well, there are more charts to show whether it's a bad thing or not, or what they're, if they are if they are being successful. But for that one in particular, it just kind of shows you what they're being asked to do.
Mm-hmm. I think that's an excellent point to make, because maybe this has come with our, maybe we're all part of this problem in the, like, the hyper analysis of everything. And that is that, you know, with the draft talk and the draft speak that comes up, and we're all gearing up, and you have to, you know, is Kelvin Benjamin 8 ounces over his weight or something like that, is that we have to find things, I won't say to talk about, but, you know, because he can't do every single route doesn't mean that, that's like saying just because a running back can't play cornerback isn't that he's not an effective player. He's a, you know, this is just what he's great at.
Yeah. Well, think about it. I mean, you look at a guy like Wes Welker and then Calvin Johnson, it's almost like they're playing two different positions. Even though they're both technically receivers, they do so many different things that it's hard to even analyze them with the same scope. And some other guy, I mean, Benjamin's is one of the more unbalanced route percentage charts that I have. But some other guys that are really unbalanced as well, guys like Julio Jones, Demaryius Thomas, Josh Gordon, those are other guys that have a really skewed percentage figures to those slants, posts, and nine routes, and those are some of the best receivers in the game. Mm-hmm. So like I said, it's not necessarily a bad thing, because those routes, like a slant route in particular, or a post route, if you can create separation on those patterns, that's a really high percentage throw for the quarterback. So it just makes sense to get your big guy, your big playmaker, the ball on those sort of passes.
Putting him in other, just making him run routes to make the route tree diverse and balanced, it would be like wasting plays for his potential. You know what I mean? If you got a guy that, I mean, basically what we're seeing here is what you've been able to do is identify statistically what his skill set is, and the way the coaching staff sees that ability is how do we best maximize him as an offensive tool on the field, not how do we just, you know, I mean, I guess I think one of the things we do is when we look at data, sometimes we want to look at like we're creating data then to create what's on the field, but actually the data represents what's going on the field.
Yeah, definitely. There's a lot of, I mean, I do a lot of work with data now at this point, and, you know, something that I always try not to do is to, you know, use the data to tell my story. I rather just let the data speak for itself and then try to come up with a conclusion based on what I've charted out, not manipulate statistics to create a story.
Joey, when you look at this route tree, can you see it well, Joey?
Okay.
He ran a 9 22% of the time. Tell us, Joey, what that means he's doing on the field.
If that make, you know, you look at that and you think, what kind of sense does that make? Because usually the 9 route guys are going to be the guys that are burners. You know,
right.
You don't want that guy that can get behind the secondary and beat them deep. But I guess what they're saying is, you know, Benjamin's not going to blow by you, but he's so much bigger than you are, you're going to have a hard time going up and getting the ball against him. And that really makes sense. You're wanting to use whatever advantage, whether it be size or strength or whatever you can do to have a better shot at getting the ball than the opposing team. And that's why these routes are the ones that work for him, a 9, a slant, and I can't see it now. But anyway, those routes in particular, he's able to get his body in between the defender and the ball and the post. Okay. Yeah, he's able to get his body between the defender and the ball, so get him in those positions. He doesn't have to run a corner route to impress me. I don't need to see him be able to run a dig. You know, those are I want to see him put in the best position to make the best possible plays, whatever route it is.
All right, so as you got these statistics, Matt, you then tell us about what you do is you try to see his actual success rate.
Right.
And chart how well he actually did when running these. Tell us what you saw with Kelvin Benjamin.
So, yeah, just like I do success rate versus coverage for each brand of coverage, like man and zone and double coverage, I try to do that for each individual route as well. And then I also chart the PTS down there as how many fantasy points they scored on those particular routes. So it kind of gives a good representation of where their production is or what routes they're producing on. So for Benjamin, we talked about that slant route. His 75.9% success rate on those slant routes is above the NFL average. So that's a good pattern for him. He runs those well because he can get the big body in between the defender and the ball. For the nine route, obviously, that's where the majority of his production comes from, and that makes sense because that's where you're getting the ball downfield, usually in close to the end zone. You're going to score touchdowns on those routes, so it makes sense that that's where most of his production is coming from. And his 53.4 success rate, that's pretty good for a guy that's, like Joe was saying, is not a burner. He's not going to run past you, but he has that big strike zone above his head. So we talked about those two patterns in particular. Those are things that he did really well. You know, he was asked to do them a lot, and he did them really well. And also, two other things I noticed with the curl route and the comeback route, again, routes that really involve a lot of size, you know, the size advantage, boxing out your opponent, he was pretty good on those as well. The one concern I did have, we talked about how he ran the post route a lot. He wasn't very successful on those routes. You know, he didn't produce a lot of fantasy points. You see only 5.5 over an 8-game sample, and his success rate versus coverage of 55.8% is below the NFL average. So I think when you look at Kelvin Benjamin, I think he's pretty clearly a quote-unquote limited player. He can't do everything yet, you know, and he's only a rookie, of course, so give him some time. You can't do everything that you'd ask a wide receiver to do, but the things he does do and what they ask him to do, he does pretty well. I know that there's definitely a narrative, especially in the fantasy community, that he was really target dependent, and it's true. He was targeted a gross amount for being, you know, a rookie who probably wasn't, you know, who wasn't one of the top guys picked in the draft, was picked in the first round, but still wasn't like a top five consensus guy. He was targeted a lot, but I think that he can still be a productive player. His, you know, efficiency can rise as he grows a little, as he and Cam develop more of a communication. So, I mean, I just think that, you know, there's sort of a narrative that wants to be created that, you know, he's only a product of his volume. But I think what reception perception shows is that while he's not perfect, you know, some of his scores were right around the average. He's not quite a superstar yet, but he is definitely a solid starting NFL wide receiver and a productive force in the Panthers offense.
Mel, how do you feel about that? Because the first thing that comes to my mind when I hear about this narrative of that it was the targets is, first, there's nobody else to target in that offense. Second, if you can do good that well in an offense that was that bad last year, how are you going to do an offense that's going to be better this year? Mel, what do you think about that?
You know, that was the first thing that came to my mind is, I mean, you had Jericho Contry and Jason Avant and Brenton Burson as the wide receivers on the other side of him, you know. This year you add in Funchess. You got Corey Brown, who's got another year under his belt. You know, you do got the speedster of Ted Ginn. So I think you're going to have less double coverage and less, he's not going to be the sole sort or the sole focus of the offense in the passing game, the number one option all the time. I really think Funchess is going to develop potentially into our number one wide receiver. And I think Benjamin's only going to get better and better because that safety is going to have to roll to the other side.
Matt, why do you think he struggled in that post route?
I think just some of the consistency with his technique. That was the way he was at Florida State, too. He wasn't always a guy that consistently ran routes at the same pace or, you know, and he shows great potential. I mean, for a guy his size, he does have some quickness to his game for sure. He's not stiff. I think he's a pretty fluid guy. It's just doing things on a consistent basis, doing the same thing the same way every time, while also mixing in a little deception to you know, confuse the corner. So, I mean, that kind of sounds like it's contradictory, but it's just a part of the grand art of playing the wide receiver position is knowing when to be consistent and when to be a little tricky with the cornerback. And I think he just is still developing some of those nuanced techniques, which is understandable because he didn't do them a lot in college. He wasn't a technique-based player. He's more of a guy who used his size, and he did that. He got away with that a lot as a rookie. So for me, I think again, that's just what he is. That's who he is. He might never be anything more than that. And like Mel said, maybe there's another player. Maybe it's Funchess. Maybe it's someone else down the line who could be more of that, you know, consistent technique guy in the offense. But for now, I think that's probably why Benjamin has a little bit of holes left in his game to fill.
And also, I think when you run that slant route, you know that linebacker or that safety is right there lurking. Yeah. And you take a couple of shots from those guys, and you're going to tread a little lightly when you're running that slant pattern.
Sure.
We did see that, you know, he's been on record saying that, you know, the season was long to him, that it wore him down mentally. There's been question marks about his focus. Maybe some people are saying that that's why he drops passes. I still haven't figured out how people understand that that's why he drops the pass. But he's extremely focused on those acrobatic catches. I just don't know how they measure that. I think they just say something to say something. But you know, there are concerns that, you know, maybe that, you know, he's had his jersey on backwards and, you know, he plays around or whatever. Do you know, are there any concerns, Joey, do you think, about him? And what Matt says, that maybe that's all he'll ever be, potentially. Like a big, huge guy that just runs down the field and says, good luck.
Well, I think the biggest benefit that he probably has going for him right now is who his position coach is. I just think that Ricky Prohl offers such a wealth of knowledge and experience that he will pick up these nuances, these subtleties, that an NFL receiver develops over time. And with Ricky Prohl, he may be able to develop these a little bit sooner just because Ricky's been through it all. You know, we know his story, how much of a hard worker he was, how he relied on skill and hard work versus pure talent to play, 16 years in the NFL, I think it was. 17. So I think that's the best thing that Benjamin has going for him is who his position coach is. And the fact that, you know, he's a young player with a young quarterback, that they're going to have time to develop a chemistry. And he'll get there. I really believe he will. And with Funchess coming in and Olsen stepping up and, you know, contributing big time, that's going to help him to get there a little bit sooner.
Hey, Matt, I got a question for you, man. I'm sorry, I'm not real familiar with the reception perception. I think it's a fantastic idea, and I'm going to start following it some more. But sure. I've got a question for you. Do you also take a look at what they do in non-passing plays in terms of blocking, effort down the field, finishing plays, that type of thing, or is it strictly route running?
Yeah, when I first debuted the series, I put a couple articles up on my website. I did have a run-blocking success rate percentage, but it just became such – I wanted to streamline the process, and it just seemed like from a lot of the feedback I was getting from readers, they didn't really care about the run blocking. So oddly enough, but it's definitely something, you know, I worked with a scouting service this last year called Optimum Scouting, and that's something that we have to account for. So it's always something I try to, you know, mentally account for, but I don't put the percentage or success rates out anymore just because I wanted to, again, streamline the process so that I could chart more receivers' routes, and it just was the more preferred information.
Yeah, no, that's fair enough.
What do you think about Funchess? Because now there's the question is we've got two really big guys. Their skill sets are not the same, even though that people like to compare them at because that they are 6'5 and 240-ish or more. But they have different types of games, I think. I think they have different attributes, and they're going to be able to gel pretty well together. What are your thoughts on Devin Funchess, and are there concerns about having another player who, I guess, is prone to dropping the football?
Yeah, it's funny. Scouting Funchess for this draft, there was the day job I just actually left to take the job with NFL.com, we used to get snow days off. Our clients wouldn't come in, but I would go in the morning just to make sure no one showed up. And one morning I was like, all right, I'm going to take these 2 hours. I'm going to watch all the Funchess tape. I'm going to figure the guy out. And I came away two hours later feeling like I hadn't learned anything. I still wasn't. I was like, I'm just as confused as I am when I got into it. Because like you said, he is that big-bodied guy like Benjamin, but he just doesn't really play that big. I think his success more comes from being so much more flexible and fluid than most guys his size. I really like him more as a short area passing weapon than Benjamin. Because one of my questions with Funchess is again, I don't like to question professional athletes' toughness because they could probably all beat me up. except maybe the kickers, but well, definitely not the kickers. But anyways,
Graham Vanilla, if you're listening. Get on Twitter now, man.
No, please don't do that. Yeah, right. So I'm not saying it's just odd to me that a guy with Funchess's dimensions, like I saw him get boxed out by 180 pound corners. I saw in the Notre Dame game from 2014 in particular. I can remember this little tiny slot corner just bringing him down by the ankles, and that just was kind of a question mark to me. Is how's he going to do against bigger, tougher competition at the pro level? Now, I know that there were some questions about whether he was playing through a toe injury, and perhaps that had something to do with it. But again, you mentioned Ricky Prohl, and that really I was just really hoping for Funchess' sake that he went to a landing spot with a good, sound, technical coach. And I think that Ricky is definitely that guy. I mean, we looked at – I thought Benjamin was – I wasn't a big Benjamin fan last year, and I didn't really like that the Panthers took him in the first round. There were other receivers I preferred, but he came
in. Neither did we.
Yeah, right. I mean, but then he came in and had a successful rookie year because, again, they knew what to ask him to do. Mm-hmm. So I think – I'm not personally sure – I'm still not sure what Devin Funchess is. I don't think he is an every-down outside receiver. I think he's more of a slot guy that you ask to win in the intermediate and short areas of the field who can be – I think he could catch a lot of passes in that role too, sort of like a Jordan Matthews who was a big guy but played a lot in the slot and just isn't really that downfield threat even though he is a big guy that ran a good 40 time. So I want to see Funchess in that sort of role, and I'm pretty confident that this receiver coach can find that role for him. And just ask, like again, like we said at the top, hey, this is what you're good at, just do this. So I think that it's going to be interesting to see him kind of take that same sort of path with Benjamin as they did with Benjamin early on.
Well, what do you think when you hear them say he's learned all three wide receiver positions in just like a couple of weeks? What do you take away from that?
Well, I think that's really encouraging. You know, you always have to kind of sift through the news this time of year, just because it's almost a lot of it is positive, and if you hear anything negative, that's usually pretty alarming because almost all coaches want to take this time to pump up players. But I do think that that's good that like they're not they're letting him learn things early on. I think that's something that's encouraging, and I think that gives them a good window now when the pads like these past mini camps where the pads weren't on everything. Let him try his hand at different things, and then sort of when you see him in training camp, when Benjamin's back in the fold, then you can kind of identify which spot he does really well. Although, again, if he develops into like a movable chess piece in the offense, I think that's a good thing too. So I think you look at that and you have to be optimistic. So just something to monitor in camp and preseason,
right?
See if he's playing in one spot or if he's moving around.
Right.
Folks on Twitter having a good time. Abby, a little feeling good. She spilled her beverage on her laptop, though. Oh, no. She said she can't tweet the show. She's watching on her phone. And we got hashtag cha-cha-cha from Joan.
Yeah, time. I like that.
all right, so let me ask you this, is then, if he is the slot guy, who the hell is going to be the other receiver?
I think I would really like to see Corey Brown get more of a shot. And I thought he played pretty well in the last in a few games towards the end of the season. And I just think that, you know, there's no, I don't know. I love a lot of old reliable veterans. And I think Jericho Cotchery, obviously, I think he's a good presence in the receiver room. You know, so I think he's a good presence in the receiver room with a lot of these younger guys. But I think that, you know, I think that Carolina is in a really unique opportunity this year to kind of really stamp control on this division. I think New Orleans is in a transitory. Yeah. I think transitory in a transitory type of period. You know, Atlanta is kind of trying to install a new system, and Tampa Bay is bringing in a new quarterback. I think that Carolina, if they really want to, I think that they can really take control of this division. And I think part of the way to do that is to develop a young offense. One thing that you see that always hurts quarterbacks is when the team doesn't put the resources in to surround them with talent. But I think right now the Panthers have done a lot. They've taken two guys in the high in the draft in back-to-back years. They've paid their one of the best tight ends in the league, in my opinion, in Olsen. And I think that Corey Brown can bring some speed that the other guys don't have to the wide receiver position. So I'd like to see him get a shot.
Here on the C3 podcast, we're not journalists. We are just fans having a good time. So we always cheer for guys. We boo guys. And one guy that I, you're not going to like me because nobody ever takes me seriously, because one guy that I am rooting for is Stephen Hill. And another guy that I'm booing against is Ted Ginn Jr. What are your thoughts on these two players? Because I think Ted Ginn Jr., talk about a guy that's soft. He might run a fast straight line 40, but he never gets deep. And I want to see Stephen Hill. I feel like people are too hard on him.
I think Ginn is a good special teams player, and I think that's probably primarily what he was brought in to do. I don't think anybody else was too inspiring in that role last year. I think they tried to put Brown in that position, but it just didn't really work out in some instances. So I think that Ginn can be a good special teams player, but yeah, I've never thought much of him as a receiver. Now, Stephen Hill, I really am gonna have to see it to believe it. I'm with you. Yeah, I know he's a popular player because of his athleticism. Of course, he did not get a fair shake in New York. I mean, nothing.
What holds him back, man? What is it that's holding him back? I mean, he's got all the tools in the world, all the speed you could ever ask
for.
He's
timid, man. He's timid. You're talking about Funchess playing soft. Is these guys are huge and fast, and they don't. It's like being a lion and not knowing you're a lion and thinking you're like a cat, like a house cat.
Yeah.
And I also think that when you look at athletic receivers like that. And you want them to be something. Sometimes you want them to be something that they're not. But at the same time, I think that those guys, of course, they have impressive physical gifts. But in order to bring those out at the NFL level, I think you have to at least have some sort of baseline level of technique and, you know, nuance to your game. And Hill just never displayed he had that. And to be fair, he was never asked to be that guy in college. You know, that Georgia Tech offense that they run. You know, there's not a lot of nuance there. It's just you're a big guy, go down the field while we do a lot of triple option plays. Now other guys have succeeded coming out of there, but that's Kelvin Johnson. He's an exception to the rule because he's just a freak, and he's a supreme talent. Demaryius Thomas is kind of a guy that was similar to Stephen Hill, but obviously he ended up with a pretty good mentor there with Peyton Manning in Denver. So I just think that, like, Demaryius Thomas is a good example of that. He's kind of a limited player like Kelvin Benjamin is, but he's really good at what those – he's developed a little bit of nuance enough for those gifts to come out in a limited role, and Stephen Hill just hasn't gotten to that level yet. So if he can do that, perhaps he makes the team. Even then, I just think there's not a lot of targets to go around, so we'll see. But, I'm going to have to see it to believe it with Hill.
Everybody, you said he's a popular player. I think he's the most unpopular player on the planet. Is everybody, they like to talk about him, but they love to trash him.
Well, yeah, I mean, I just think that, I don't know. I mean, if it's kind of just one of those Hail Mary acquisitions to me, you know. But hey, what I'll say is that they kept him on the practice squad all last year. They must see something in him, and Ricky Proehl must like working with him. He must be taking to coaching, because if he didn't, there wouldn't be any reason he'd still be
gone
there
by now. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, so he's raved about him in that way. He's gone on and on about like how good he is, like at being coached. Yeah.
So and that's a good thing too, because something that was never given to him in New York was a lot of confidence. I mean, you saw Rex Ryan, as soon as they drafted him, came out and said, yeah, that wasn't really my guy. I wouldn't have taken him, which just doesn't make any sense for a coach to do. Like I said, this is the time of year when you want to instill a lot of confidence in your players. So that's another good thing that they do in Carolina.
You know what doesn't make a lot of sense is Rex Ryan being a head coach. I mean, that's just pretty bonehead. All right, look, what we've got is we've got pretty fun. Speaking of making sense, we play a little game each week that we call Finish That Thought, where I pose a thought and you guys finish it. So let's go ahead and jump into that real quick, because you'll like this, because we got
sometimes
good sound effects.
I just don't get people. Human beings are so weird. Who talks in front of a camera by themselves for fun? Who thought that was a good idea? These ideas, some of these things that you use every day.
This is
a guy or a girl that looks like
this makes no sense.
Good idea. That's a good
idea. It's time for Finish That Thought, where I pose the thought and you guys finish it. And guys, I believe that Devin Funchess says that he wants to be Rookie of the Year. So the thought, Offensive Rookie of the Year, that's his goal. The idea of Devin Funchess coming in with that level of confidence, Joe, is?
Coming in with that level of confidence is, to me, encouraging. Makes me feel like he, maybe he's ready to start playing like we expect him to. And step his game up once he gets to this next level of football.
This is Devin Funchess.
The goal that I set for myself is to be Rookie of the Year. What surprised me the most is having to really do something on my own. You know, in college, everybody has to be here, be there at that time, and have it.
So, Mel, I'm going to ask you this. As he said, what surprised him most about coming to the NFL was having to do something on his own. The idea of doing something on your own is?
Oh, it's welcome to the real world, man. You know, it's kind of a cold splash of water in your face, man. It's part of growing up. So, you know, he said a lot this week. He also said that he and Kelvin Benjamin were going to wreak havoc on the NFC South. You know, I think he's got a, you know, I'm pulling for him. Like you said, we're fans. I'm pulling for him, but he is a rookie. You go out and prove it. Just concentrate on the game, baby.
All right, Matt. This wide-eyed optimism from Devin Funchess, the enigma, the guy, the man of mystery, is?
Admirable. It's good to come in. Confidence is so much a part of being a good football player, so it's good that he's confident. As far as being Offensive Rookie of the Year, that'll be a tough task in this in this particular offense, and with a lot of other talented players he'd have to pass up. It's admirable, but all you know that'll probably be all that it is.
Is it going to be Melvin Gordon?
I would, you know, I don't know. That's a good question. He seems like the obvious candidate. I would keep an eye out on Amir Abdullah, the Lions running back, because it usually goes to a running back or a quarterback. So if Winston comes in and has a good year, Mariota will probably be one of those two guys.
Well, how about Gurley, man? You know, I'm a Gurley man myself.
Oh yeah, I mean, I love Todd Gurley, but I don't think he's going to play enough this year to get there. I think that they've pretty much said as soon as they drafted him that they're going to be cautious with him. I think he is an all-world talent, and I think he'll be easily the best running back from this draft class. But I think they have a good running back there in Trey Mason already, and so that they can afford to be to be cautious and bring him along slowly. So he probably just won't rack the statistics up enough to warrant that award.
Matt, I know that you've got to move. Like, when are you leaving? If you need to go, we are going to finish up the show. We got, like, 10 more minutes. You can hang out, or I know you got a lot of stuff on your plate. I don't want to just hold up your whole night.
No, that's okay. I can stick around for 10 more minutes or so. But, yeah, I definitely am. I think I got enough packing in today. we joke around at the apartment, whenever, like, this current apartment that I'm leaving, my two roommates and I, we always joke, oh, well, you did a lot of work. Now you can have a piece of cake. So I did a lot of packing this afternoon, and I did have a piece of cake. So I've already rewarded myself for the day. I'm off for the night.
Awesome, awesome. All right, well, then we'll just have some fun here in the last few minutes of the show, guys. It's been a quiet day, quiet week in football overall. People are taking their time off. Some of our favorite players are going on game shows. And Thomas Davis, this past week, made an appearance on a celebrity NFL version of Family Feud. Nice. And this is Thomas Davis on Family Feud.
Or talk to 100 men. You good at reading body language. What part of a woman speaks the loudest?
Her thighs.
Huh? Yeah, now we're talking. Yes, Lord.
Them thighs.
Yes, Lord.
Them thighs.
Yes, Lord. The thighs is the reason that the miniskirt was invented. Now, it ain't up here, but that's a good answer.
So Thomas Davis goes, he said, what speaks the loudest on a woman? I think the answer was like her hairdo. That was the last one. And he says, them thighs. Joe, first, you know, my very first thing I'm going to be working on all week is a song called Them Thighs by Thomas Davis. Second, my favorite part of that video is, Joe, the guy in the background, and I think, was it Vernon Davis? I don't know who it was.
Vernon Davis was on the, yeah.
Them Thighs! Joe, Thomas Davis, the man of the year. He's a thigh man. What do you think about that?
I think that was a good answer because you didn't want to go with the obvious ones because, you know, his old lady might have had something to say about that. So you go with something a little unexpected that's not so obvious. I think that was a pretty smart move on his part.
He's totally a cool cat. Also, an underrated piece of chicken, the thigh.
Very much so. Very much so.
Good chicken. I'll take the breast.
In which category?
I'll plead the fifth there, buddy.
So then he goes on to say this. Then we got more. It gets better. They asked them about words that follow the word strip.
Word.
Yeah, I think you said
Rod. Name something that follows the word strip. We gotta go to Thomas. Thomas?
Club.
You said Rod, man. Strip club. Thomas, man, two strikes. All the stuff we normally do is gone. Name something that follows the word strip.
A strip set.
A strip set. Now.
So, I think his name is something Clay. I almost want to call him Cassius Clay. He plays for the Arizona Cardinals. He goes, can he change his answer? Can he change his answer? A strip set. What did he mean there, Mel, by a strip set?
I have no idea. Honestly, you know, I think Thomas Davis had three final X's on that show where he got the third X.
So he's not your Family Feuder guy. Matt, you think he meant strip sack?
Could be. Or, you know, like a set, like a performance. I mean, he was talking about the clubs, so maybe that's what he meant.
Point.
I'm sure Kelly Davis was saying, what?
I don't get a dance. I get a set.
Yeah. Well, when you sign a big contract extension, you get the whole set.
Right. You get the lap set, not a lap dance. You get the lap set.
And the thighs.
And the thighs. That's right.
I don't think Kelly Davis is having any of that though.
But I have to agree with that there.
Guys, we're going to close out the show with our favorite segment. I thought that was fun. We got to talk. Actually, let me ask you this. Fact or fiction, we're not going to play the game tonight, but Joe, fact, you would roll with Thomas Davis to the strip club.
That is a definite fact.
Matt.
Come on, no hesitation. Fact.
No hesitation. Now.
Nah, I'm going to have to say fiction, man. I stay out of those places.
Oh, no
He's
way.
He's such a liar, too.
Sorry.
He,
sorry,
he lives in Las Vegas.
I'm in my middle 40s, dude. I'm not going to some club to watch girls my daughter's age trip. It's not
going to be I'm 23, so I'll take
my... Hey, 23, you ought to be going. You should be going. Now, when you get to be 44...
First of all, it's made for people in their mid-40s.
Exactly.
They're nobody's daughter at the strip club. Don't you worry.
No.
And third of all, I'm going to say fiction. I'm going with Greg Hardy.
Oh, God.
You need to go with Money Mayweather, man.
That's right. That's my too.
Yeah,
I roll with all the people Mel would not. All right, so here's what we do. I don't know if you are familiar with our favorite. We started the C3 podcast, Matt, was just me and Joey. We called it the Halftime Hangout, and we would get up here during halftime of the Carolina Panthers game and just talk to each other for 5 minutes. Basically, we were doing this on the telephone anyway because we're former college roommates, and now so we were just like, let's just do it on YouTube. Nobody watched. It's okay. We didn't watch it either. But we started, what we did is we said, we got to do some segments. So our very first segment, I believe, it was either this or Breaking Down the Box. And Joe, it's time for our ice up picks of the week. Are you ready, sir?
I am ready.
This is the time where we tell somebody in the NFL, the Twitter world, anywhere to ice up, son, if they need to get their act together. There are no limits in the ice up, son segment. We have called out 12-year-old boys. So, Mel, you think it's bad talking about 20-year-old girls at the strip club? Mm-hmm. I talk shit to 12-year-old kids from Oklahoma all the time. So, Joey, what is your ice up pick of the week?
All right. As sports fans, we love good comeback stories. This is especially true of what looked like a warming of the relationship between MLB and the prodigal son, Pete Rose. This could have been one of the best comeback stories of all times. For 26 years, Rose has denied or has stuck to the same storyline. He never bet on baseball as a player. Recently, documents have shown up proving otherwise. ESPN's Outside the Lines has pages from a seized notebook belonging to longtime associate Michael Bertoloni. And they were pages from a notebook that was seized in a 1989 raid by the U.S. Postal Inspection Service. They were they basically indicated that Pete Rose bet extensively on the Reds while he was playing for the team.
Did he bet for them to lose, though?
From what I saw a couple of photographs of the document. It looked like he had them winning. So, so he would have wanted to play his hardest and his best to try to, you know, cover.
Yeah, I see no problem with it.
This is sad to me because Rose had a chance to come completely clean. Admitting that he bet on games as a manager in 2004, he should have just admitted to the whole thing. Mm-hmm. You know, they gave him, he took the opportunity to say, hey, I will admit I bet as a manager. At that point, just say, and as a player. Fans are willing to forgive, and time does heal all wounds, but when continuing a lie only to have it proven that you lied again, you'll be branded a liar, and fans will forget all your on-field accomplishments and only remember you as a liar. So to you, Pete Rose, I say, ice up, liar.
Liar. Way to finish strong, Joe.
Way to,
ice
well
up, Pete Rose, liar. And you know what? I wish I would have known that's how you get close because I would have got that old Rollins song out.
Oh, yeah.
Close, I'm a liar.
He just screams, I'm a liar the whole time. Mel, You know, speaking of coming clean and all of that, I go to strip club all the time. No, I'm just kidding. Actually, coming clean.
Miranda's knocking on the door there.
My wife is out with her friend. She went to go see that Magic Mike movie.
She's at the strip club.
She's at the strip club. What I was going to say is that, you know, we do forgive people in America that come clean. Joey, you're the Yankees fan.
Andy Pettit.
Nobody has a problem with Andy Pettit. We hate everybody else. The one that I hate the most is the the guy that was a Ranger in a Baltimore Oriole who told Congress over and over that he had never taken steroids, and then he failed a drug test like the next day.
I can't think of his name, but I mean, I can see his face.
Mel, you've got a nice up pick for us, I believe.
I do. I don't know if you got the picture for me or not. But yeah. You know, well, hey, my first thought for Ice Up Sunday's pick this week was going to be lighthearted. I was going to take old Michael Jordan for turning down 6 picks for Frank Kaminsky. I think that's a great
player. That sounds like a baseball player.
That's a great candidate. But you know what? I decided to go a little bit more serious, a little bit more real, something that gets me a little bit pissed off. And this is something that, you know, there's been a lot of controversy about flags.
I don't even like putting it up on the screen.
I know. It's pretty ridiculous, you know. But, guys, we live in a world where we as humans we're flawed people. There's nobody that's just a perfect person, right? I mean, and every society has bad people, bad things that go on. Yes, there are bad police officers out there. But you know what? If the difference between a third world country and the United States of America is our police force. It's our military, right? It keeps us safe. It keeps us having the ability to come on and do fun things like what we're doing tonight. Yes, you know, the Confederate flag, hey, you know, there's a lot of division over that, a lot of hatred that goes into that. I personally am for that coming down and going into a museum. But this weekend, the 4th of July weekend, there is a group going into Brooklyn, and they're known as the Disarm the NYPD group. And they got 300 people coming into town burning the American flag. And their rationale is saying that the American flag stands for the same thing that the Confederate flag did, oppression and racism. You know what? I will start the fundraiser tonight for any of you jackasses that want to burn the American flag, and hey, thank God we live in a country that you have the right to do that and not be killed for it. But for any of you jackasses that want to do that, I'll start the fundraiser tonight to buy you a ticket out of town. You want to go live in Mexico City? Go for it, man.
25 million people there.
America,
50 million people in one city.
Are we a perfect country? No, we're not a perfect human race. But we are by far not even a close second. We are the best country in the world. So for all you jackasses that want to go out there and take the imperfection of humanity of some people in America and burn the flag and pound your chest, I tell you two things. One, kiss my ass, and two, ice up, son.
It's not a perfect world. It's not a perfect world. We're not perfect. I mean, every stripper is somebody's daughter. Right.
That's very true. That's why
we learned that lesson. Damn, Mel, way to ruin it for everybody.
I know. Wait, how old's your daughter? How old's your youngest daughter?
My daughters are babies, like little baby dolls.
Okay, so when they get to be 20, you come tell me if you're going to go to the strip club. I don't think you will. Sorry to be the downer.
No way, you are a downer. And you know what? As I hate, my best friend in Las Vegas is the guy that when we go there, we're not going to get to go to strip club.
You enjoy this. Like,
all right, Mel, nice seeing you. I'm going to the strip club. All right, Matt, do you, by any chance, I know we're putting you on the spot, would you like to offer an ice-up pick for this week?
Oh, man, this is on the spot. I don't know. I guess I've been too much in my own bubble lately. I don't know if I have one that's not too much of a...
No Twitter wars, no nothing. No, nothing. No guy to pull out in front of you.
Falcons fans, Saint fans, those are the go-to.
Okay, I'll go for you guys. I'll go for you, and I'll say this, is that this week I have an unfortunate ice-up pick, and it's myself. I'm icing up myself this week, guys. Yeah, I know, is that usually I'm very aggressive in my ice-up picks. I'm coming after myself, even though I almost changed at the last second with this food truck show on the Cooking Channel, where there was one food truck that wanted to be witches and wizards. It was their shtick, and I didn't get that. but I'm going to ice up myself because we recently started a series on CarolinaCatChronicles.com that we know is going to be a tremendous success. We had a wonderful debut. It's called Where's That Cat Now?, where we catch up with a former Carolina Panther, and we interview them, and we just see what they're doing now, and we kind of celebrate their career in the process. We started with Will Witherspoon. We had a fantastic talk with him. Right before I go on vacation in a hurry, guys, I had the opportunity to speak with Mike Minter, and I spent 30 minutes with Mike Minter, and we had the most wonderful conversation. It turned into so much more than I could have ever wanted it to be. At one point, I had him belly laughing. And my computer and my settings were screwed up, and it only recorded my side of the conversation. So I'm going to give myself I know. And I'm so embarrassed. I was so embarrassed I couldn't call and be like, I'm sorry, Mike, but this jackass that tracked you down screwed up. So Professor, to you, Tony Dunn, ice up, son.
If you want me to play Mike Minter and fill on the other side of it for next week, I'm available.
So good. It was so good. And the only person that ever gets to hear it is me.
Charles Barkley would say, that's terrible.
That was terrible. All right, guys. I know Matt's got to go. Matt, why don't you tell everybody where they can find their work and tell them where you're heading and where they can find your work. And I'm going to play some music on the way out.
Sure, you can find me on Twitter at MattHarmon_VYB. You can find my work soon enough. You can find it at NFL.com. And for now, you can still find me at TheBackyardBanter.com, which is my website where I'll link everything out anyways.
Joe, that freaking Puerto Rican, Lazarus, resurrected, back with us again. We're glad you were here. Tell them where they can find you from now on.
You guys can find me on Twitter at Joe Riolano. I am excited about this upcoming season. I can't wait for training camp. We're going to be there at Fan Fest. We're going to be there at Spartanburg. We got a lot coming up. Fantasy football just around the corner, folks. I know it's that time of year. People are starting to get antsy. Susan was on Twitter today defending her title, talking smack.
Mel, where can they find you?
Hey, you can always get me at Panthers Drafter with an S on Twitter, without an S at email. But always out there, man, always talking Panther football. And as Joe said, man, Panther football or fantasy football is right around the corner. I got people hitting me up every day asking to get in the league. You want in, hit me up on Twitter. Let me know. Matt, we'd love to have you in the league. It's a 48-team super league. Nothing like it, man. Wow. Giving away Luke Kuechly autographed football. The winner wins a Shaq Thompson jersey and $300 cash.
It's exciting, guys.
Oh, not bad.
It's a four 12-team leagues put together into one super league, where each league sends the top three to a bracket at the end, and they play like a super playoff. So you don't have to have the 985th running back. It's pretty fun. We had a lot of success last year. Guys, this is the Professor, a.k.a. Tony Dunn. This is the C3 Podcast. You can find me every Tuesday night here talking Carolina Panthers. In the meantime, or at other nights of the week, you can find me at the strip club. That's right. Blowing it out. Dollar, 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 bill, y'all. you guys can check us out at CarolinaCatChronicles.com. We've got tons of great stuff coming up. The Fantasy Football Challenge is coming up. And, guys, we've got a big surprise. And all I'm going to say is, wow. Wow. It's coming, folks. 10 days. It'll be here in the mail. That's the C3 Podcast.
Yes, sir. Can't wait, man.
We will check you out next Tuesday.